our town hall series, the Critical Conversations in World Language Education. I'm Victoria Russell, and I'm the 2022 ACTFL president. I'm also a professor of Spanish and foreign language education at Valdosta State University in Georgia. Before we get started, I want to thank a couple of really important people that made this webinar happen. I'd first like to thank our Advocacy and Outreach Committee co-chairs, Pam Benton and Brenda Gaber. Please give us a wave. They organized the panelists, the topic, and so forth with their committee, so I'm very grateful to them. I'd also like to give a shout out to Celia Zamora, who is the ACTFL Director of Professional Learning and Certification. She has been doing a lot of work behind the scenes to make this happen. So thank you very much. Let's go on to the next slide. This is one of our series. We have five pillars in the strategic plan for ACTFL. So this is the advocacy and outreach pillar. And we've had a critical conversation. We're doing one on each of these pillars. So if we move on to the next slide, I can show you the ones that we've done already. We did the teacher recruitment and retention one. We talked about diversifying and increasing the teacher education pipeline. We know that we have a massive teacher shortage, including in rural languages, and that was in April. And by the way, if you missed any of these, the recordings are available on the ACTFL website, along with reflection questions that were written by the panelists. So you can use these for professional development in your districts, in your schools, and so forth. The diversity, equity, and inclusion one was on teaching anti-racism, and that was held in May. And the research and assessment focused on research on how to support heritage language learners in mixed classrooms. This is our fourth one, and we're talking about advocating for change, all about advocacy and how to make our voices heard. And then our final webinar in this series is from the Professional Development Committee, and their topic is addressing identity, inclusive language in world language classrooms, and that will be held on September 22nd. Let's go on to the next slide. Our topic, of course, tonight is advocating for change, how to be heard. Just a couple of housekeeping items before I give the bios of our presenters. If all of you could turn your cameras off and make sure you're muted, that would ensure that our ASL interpreters are able to be seen, as well as our panelists who are speaking. So if at this time, if you could turn off your cameras and make sure that you're muted, that would be especially helpful. Now I'm going to go ahead and introduce our panelists before I turn it over to them for our actual webinar. So tonight we have Elizabeth Jimenez Salinas, Megan Jeffrey, and Tyler Higgins. And I'm going to just read you quick biographies on each of those. So Elizabeth grew up bilingual in English and Spanish. She earned a BA in Spanish from California State University at Fullerton. And she also completed some of her undergraduate coursework abroad in Mexico. She has taught bilingual first, second, and third grade classes, as well as university level methods classes and reading classes. She served as a legislative aide to Assemblymember Peter Chacon in the California State Legislature, pioneering K through 12 bilingual education legislation. She also helped launch bilingual education in public schools of Puerto Rico through the Escuela de Idiomas de Puerto Rico. Elizabeth is a founding member of Californians Together, the coalition that developed the state's seal of biliteracy. She then worked with the state of Hawaii to institute the Hawaii State Seal of Biliteracy. Elizabeth earned an MBA from Claremont Graduate University while working in the US educational textbook publishing arena. She now has her own company and consults for all major US educational publishers. For 6 years, she served as a contract lobbyist in Sacramento, working for the State Board of Education in the legislature. She has written and published children's books in Spanish, including her best known, Lalo. Megan Jeffrey is the Director of Strategic Initiatives and Communication at the National Foreign Language Center at the University of Maryland, where she focuses on initiatives to unite people through world language and global culture. She holds degrees in international educational policy and Chinese from the University of Maryland and numerous executive certificates from the Johns Hopkins University. Tyler Higgins began his language journey in a partial Spanish immersion elementary school program. This sparked an interest that led him to Georgetown School of Foreign Service, as well as study abroad journeys to Chile, Spain, and Brazil. Today, Tyler uses his linguistic experiences to navigate everyday experiences at home and overseas, to connect with international friends, and to support his professional work. Now we're going to go ahead and turn it over to Elizabeth.
Aloha, good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for joining us. And my little topic is going to be about shaping a successful advocacy campaign. It's something that as educators, we may want to be involved in, but how do you get it started? How does it work? So next slide, if you would. I've shared this quote, advocacy is not what we do for others, but what we do with others to transform our community. When I started as a bilingual teacher, my very, very first year of teaching, I started in January because it was a teacher that was off on maternity leave. And the other teachers of our grade level decided to give me some of their really challenging students. So I had quite a beginning experience. But one of the things that came up quite a bit in staff meetings and discussion was that colleagues were sharing that, you know, what is it with the students who speak Spanish? Their parents don't seem to care about education. They never come to the parent conferences. They don't show up for back to school night, etc. And I hadn't had that experience at all with my class. Moms would come before school or after school, having worked in the fields where they just smelled of garlic. It was wonderful. And they would talk to me, what can I do? How can we help? What else should my child be doing? And so I was perplexed that they were finding that the families just didn't care. So it turned out that many of the students that I worked with were in a migrant camp because their parents worked in the fields. And I decided, along with my aide, my paraprofessional, that we were going to go out there and meet with the families of the kids in my class. And what an experience, what a learning experience that was for me. I learned that it wasn't that parents didn't care, but rather many parents did not have any transportation. They relied on the farmer to provide them transportation at about 3:30 in the morning to get to the fields to go to work, which meant that by 6:30 in the evening, they were in bed asleep. And so if we held a meeting at 7 p.m., there wasn't any way that they were going to be able to attend. Another was about the parent conferences and getting parents to come. We held them on half days when kids would get out at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Well, parents were working, and if they took time off of their job, they could be fired or not be paid. And all of that was a problem. So I learned this and I wanted to share it, but I was a brand new teacher and I wanted to share it with my colleagues. I also wanted to try to help change things so that we were doing more outreach and not expecting that parents would come to us. So I thought about this, how do I do this? How do I do this? And I thought to myself, I can't do this. I'm a brand new teacher. I don't know the community that well. What can I do? So next slide. The next thing I figured out was we could make a difference. We could make some changes, but I needed to organize and get together with others and work together with others who were like-minded in this same kind of work and to be an active networker and to join organizations that were about this kind of thing. And one of the things that we figured out was, okay, so the teachers that we worked with didn't want to go to the migrant camp to do the parent outreach. And the parents were unable to come. So the question we asked was, where else do the families come together? And what we figured out was, the answer to that was church. And so we went to talk with the priest at their church, and he was very, very willing to put out announcements and share information that had more to do with education, but he also wanted his community to do well. So organizing, joining an organization like ACTFL and others helps us to really be able to win when we're in advocacy and we're trying to have an issue or a proposal of some sort or a problem taken care of. Next slide. Now, this is about developing a plan for advocacy and all kinds of steps, and it is quite a process. In fact, I think about it as if you've ever had to plan a quinceañera or a wedding, something like that, a big conference. It's the same kind of thing where there are lots of moving parts. You need to calendarize the steps, figure out what that, you know, how we'll get successfully to the final outcome. So what I've done here is to list for you the really main issues and questions, and I'll go over it a little bit. If in the future we want to do a more robust training at a conference or in your state, I'm very, very glad to share with you all the tools that we've created to be successful with some of these issues. So let's look at the very first one. It says, identify the issue, proposal, or problem. So I knew in the instance that I was talking about, and in many other times, what the issue was. For example, we had fewer students matriculating into our world language classes and a shortage of world language teachers. Also, in California, for the last 2 years, we worked on creating a pathway to biliteracy award. So if you go on the California Department of Education website, you can see that. It's not just about giving the state seal of biliteracy, but having a pathway all along, which really helps to get parents excited, kids excited, schools to be more knowledgeable of it, so forth. So identify what that is. The next thing that you want to do is decide who are the main targets of change. What do I mean by that? The targets of change might be your school board members, your legislators, your college board of trustees. And then beyond who's going to make the decision, who are the agents or those that could bring some pressure to bear on those targets? So when we organize, we get together and think about, okay, so if we wanted to do a pathway to biliteracy, that's a local decision through our school board. So who are the people that the school board members know and trust and will listen to and meet with? And then the next step in all of this is, once we know where we're headed, do we have to go to the legislature? Do we have to go to the school board? We're going to identify who our key allies and possible opponents are. Now, this is a very interesting exercise because some of the people or groups that you think may be your opponents turn out, wow, they really could be allies, and vice versa. So this is a brainstorming activity of thinking about all of the different possibilities. So I'll give you an example. When we were working on the seal of biliteracy, it was very, very interesting. First of all, our main target was the legislature. We wanted to go to the California legislature and get this passed so that it could be statewide. Very interesting. It did pass the legislature during that 2-year session. But then it went to the governor, an English learner himself, a speaker of other languages, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and he vetoed the bill. So in the next session of the legislature, we came back, same thing. We addressed his veto message and got people on board in the legislature, and they voted for it, and he vetoed it again. So then we said, okay, this has been 4 years. We're not getting this through at the state level. Let's do something local. And so we put together a resolution, like a template, that school boards could use to adopt a seal of biliteracy in their own district. We had over 100 school districts in California adopt it. And so then when we got a new governor, Jerry Brown, and the next 2 year legislative session, we were able to bring that forward and say, look at all of the support that's out there. And there were many districts that you would kind of be surprised that they had taken that on. So the idea of identifying who are your possible allies. So for the seal of biliteracy, it was parents of English learners, but it was also parents of English speakers who had learned a new language, world language students, chambers of commerce, the American Hospital Association, and the Library Association. So these were some of the allies that we came up with. There were many, many more. But then there were also some potential opponents, including some very conservative groups and parents of English-only students, for in some instances, why isn't my child getting some kind of an award, et cetera. So anyway, it's important to figure out who those opponents are and then know your audience. When it's time to go to the state board, or it's time to go to your local school board or legislature or whomever to make your case, you really need to know who you're talking to. And you might think, geez, I don't know any legislators. How would I? Okay, so nowadays we can go online and we can learn a lot of information about who sits on the education committee and who sits on the finance committee. And what are their interests and what party do they serve, et cetera, et cetera. So when I say know your audience, I want to think about who we're talking to. And then these three things. First of all, I said, count the votes. Well, how can you count the vote if they haven't voted? Well, let's say there are 9 members on the committee. And 5 of them are Democrats. And 4 of them are Republicans. All right, I might make some assumptions up front because of the issue that I'm working on. And then I want to look very closely at how have they voted on such issues in the past. And then I also want to have somebody talking to each of these individuals. Now, if you've never talked to your legislator, number one, don't be afraid. Okay, sometimes we go in all nervous because, well, this person's in power. The only reason they're in power is because we have voted them in. So go in and talk to them as you would to a neighbor and find out from them, where do they stand? Be very direct about that. You know, where are they with this issue? The second thing it says on my list is to do your research. So that's, again, going back and looking at the committee. What have they voted on in the past? What are some of their personal and professional interests? Which members represent you and others in your coalition? So if I find out that on the education committee, my local representative sits on that committee, guess what? I'm going to be the one to reach out. I may invite them to my school to see our world language program. I may invite them to come and meet with parents, whatever it might be, but use that connection. And then the third is to target your remarks. So very early on in my experience in Sacramento organizing testimony on behalf of my boss and his bilingual education bill, we found out as much as we could about each legislative member. My boss presented the bill, and then members could ask questions and make comments. As the testimony proceeded, one conservative Democrat from the agricultural part of the state said, well, this is all well and good, but where I represent, Portuguese is the language, not Spanish. The very next person we had testify was the president of the Luso-American Education Foundation. The legislator sat back in his chair and smiled. We had done our homework and really targeted those remarks. Okay, next, we're going to, what are the channels for change? So beyond just maybe going to your local school board, one of the biggest change agents or channels has been lawsuits. And I just wanted to share with you, not because I'm in it, but a book that we've created at Californians Together. And in this book, it gives you a number of advocacy case studies and how we were able to make some very serious changes. But if you think of things like Lau versus Nichols and other lawsuits that have set the stage to say, yep, we got to have legislation, we've got to move forward and have these things occur. So thinking back way, way back in California in the 60s, students were required to take an IQ test. And the IQ test was in English. So as you can imagine, there were many students who were arriving who did not speak English, took that test, and then were placed in special education. Well, we worked with a legal group, and they did some venue shopping, which means they found a place where this was occurring, and they found a judge who had a child who was a special education student. And that judge became furious when he heard the State Department of Education saying, oh, but we have to do this and we have to do it in English because we only have English speaking teachers and we only have the test in English, et cetera, et cetera. So the lawsuits are a very, very important part of getting things rolling. The inventorying our resources, now that we've laid out our plan, what we're going to do. We need to figure out how much money are we going to need. We're going to use volunteers, so that part may not cost us, but how are we going to, what kind of mailings do we need to do, or people who have training on using the media, etc. So you notice on here that I talked about the inventory, the resources. I want to mention that this notion of feet on the street is one that takes me back to working in the legislature. It was often said that when legislators were approached or their offices were asked about holding a meeting with somebody or with a group, that there were three things they were interested in. Number one, do you have money to contribute? Now notice, they cannot ask you when you're in the state government buildings, they cannot talk about money or campaigns or any of that. But they're thinking about that. Oh, these people represent some very wealthy individuals or some PACs or organizations, okay? So number one, do you have any money to contribute? Number two, do you have feet on the street? Maybe you don't have any money, but as a union or an organization, feet on the street, meaning you can go and knock on doors or make phone calls or hand out door hangers, that kind of thing. And then the third one is, can you vote for me? So that's the third consideration. Are you a constituent? Because if you can vote for me, I probably want to meet with you. I don't want to leave that alone. And then finally, I talk about strategies. I want to mention that in strategies, we as educators, especially those of us at the university level, we think all I'll do is just bring them a ton of data and show them all the data that has to, what it has to say about learning world language. Well, let me tell you that the data is and other proof are not as compelling. And what I say is that we need legislation by anecdote. come in and tell a story about a family or a community or an individual child or teacher and make it really palpable what this need is and, you know, where we're going. Next slide. And then finally, with those strategies that we select, with those strategies that we use, then the tactics are the action steps. So just like making a plan for your school for the year or making a plan for some event that you're doing, we get the idea, like strategies. Okay, we're going to do some, we want some media attention. We're going to have to do some demonstrations or testimony or advertising, whatever the strategy. But then we've got to lay it out. Who's going to do what? What exactly is it? By when? And then the very last bullet on this page says, assess your progress, make changes, be flexible. When in California, we had a ballot initiative that prohibited bilingual education for almost 20 years in California. And that's how we started the Seal of Biliteracy, was since there were not widespread programs that were bilingual programs, we wanted the kids who came with language assets or who developed them in school to have some kind of very positive to go with, right? So when the initiative on the ballot passed and prohibited bilingual education, we actually held a retreat and went over every single thing we did in the campaign that worked, things that didn't work, what we would do differently. And we decided at that time to organize, to form a coalition that has gone on now for over 20 years, Californians Together, and to use that organization to get out in front of these issues, study them, get people on board, and make the change. Thank you.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone, depending upon where you are joining from. My name is Megan Jeffrey, and I work for the National Foreign Language Center, which is a part of the University of Maryland. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Lectia, which is our language app, which we focus on equity with this app. So next slide, please. So first, before I get into Lectia, I want to introduce myself a little bit and my background a little bit more than what was said earlier. I have always been a language lover from the time I was a child. I remember I probably was about 3 or 4 years old, and I had a sister who had a speech impediment and language difficulties, and my parents just could not understand her. And I remember they would always call me in and say, you know, Megan, what is she saying? And I would look at her, she would say something, and then I would just say, oh, okay, this is what she said, you know. And so from the jump, I've always just been in love with global languages and different cultures and things of that nature. I went on to study Mandarin and Farsi, Russian, Lingala, Spanish, and Tagalog. So it was very natural for me to come into this role at the National Foreign Language Center, where I focus on helping people connect with others and understand each other and the world around them, which is the mission of the National Foreign Language Center. So we created an app, Lectia, which again is a language learning app. And we noticed, and I'll talk about this in the next slide a little bit, but we noticed that there was a big gap in the market for language learning products. Number one, it wasn't available to everybody. So we wanted to create an app that was free with zero ads. And so it would be accessible by all, no matter socioeconomic status or location. And we took a cognitive approach to learning when we built this app. So we use in-depth and authentic material, which is developed by and for native speakers. And what that really translates to is we're using things that you'll see in the country where the languages are spoken. So things like library card applications or apartment listings and those kinds of things. So we're really targeting learners in a way that, like, really taps into how the language is truly spoken by natives. We've also built a lot of support tools in here that we didn't see on the market either. And currently we have 7 languages and we're adding 12 more. So the 7 languages that we currently have are listed here, but we have 12 more coming in the fall. And while it's in the App Store now, it will also be in Google Play in the fall as well. So right now it's only available to a certain population, right? But we've got plenty of requests and, you know, when is it coming to Google Play? We want Android users want to have it. So we're doing that too soon. And go to the next slide, if you will, please. So this is why we created Lexia. As I was mentioning, there was a gap in the market. There was lots of gamification apps, but nothing at a higher level. And we're really focused on language equity, which we want this app to be for everyone. We want this to be available to all populations, no matter socioeconomics. And it also targets all the levels, including heritage speakers and teachers. And another thing that we thought was important was really creating a really thorough language learning experience. And part of that is background notes about different terminology, slang, things that you're not going to get in a textbook, and things that quite frankly aren't available in most apps. So we were really focused on that. And then also 3 different populations we're really focused on too. Is like 1, the language learner, like the everyday, this is my second language, I want to learn. And so we've built support tools and helping that population. And then we thought about heritage speakers. There's not a lot of apps on the market that target somebody who already might understand a language, but just not know the reading and the writing portion of it. And then we also thought about teachers and language teachers or language educators in particular, because we want them to supplement their lessons with this. And so you can go to the next slide. And so the future of Lexia, and I'll stay on this for a little bit because I want to talk a little bit more about what we're doing in terms of advocating for languages in particular. So we are focused on adding new languages, and while we are adding 12 more languages, we don't have any African languages in particular. We don't have any indigenous languages, and we are a grant-funded organization, so we are currently looking for ways to develop new languages, because how can we go about saying this app is for everybody, but it's only got 19 languages? So we're really focused on those kinds of pathways to add more languages. So we're pretty focused on African languages right now, and really looking to find support for those, because there's a huge African American population in the United States, and we offer in most schools typical things like French and Spanish, but do we ever think about other languages that are native to Africa that perhaps African Americans are maybe interested in for other reasons? Like, you know, we all understand that African Americans unfortunately have a terrible history of how they were brought here. And we think it is unfair that there's not a lot of equity in this area. So we're particularly focused on that. And also, of course, with indigenous languages. Now, as part of my role as the Director of Strategic Initiatives and Communication, my goal is to get this in front of as many people as possible. So here's the QR code you can download. You could share this. I would love for everybody to use this. Again, it's free. There's no ads, there's not gonna be any interruptions. It's really focused on language maintenance and boosting proficiency levels. This is not while we do have beginner, intermediate, and advanced levels, the beginner level, really, you should have some understanding, like maybe you've started studying language already. So it's not like a basic kind of thing. So anyway, spreading awareness is my job, and I want to get in front of lots of people. So what have I been doing? Like we write different press releases about this. We talk to teachers, teacher organizations. We do lots of different things. Social media, we've increased a ton. I think we've increased our numbers by 66% of our following base on across social media platforms. So we really like to engage with everybody and want them to know that this is free and this is, you know, something that's available. We also want to get in front of libraries and just put this everywhere because we do believe that everybody deserves to be able to learn a language and one specific more to maybe their heritage or family or something like that. So we've also done email campaigns and videos, doing presentations, lots of different things. So that's the way that we are advocating for change within the language community. It's just really focusing on the equity portion. And also something that we think about often is there's a lot of, well, we're a part of the University of Maryland, which already has a language school that is dedicated to the for students. So we've got bachelor's and master's students and maybe PhD students who could take courses, but what about those people who are already beyond college years or who are professionals and want to use that in their work? So we want to just add to what's already out there instead of just, you know, we're not trying to compete for anything. We want to see the language community grow, particularly within the United States of America. And yeah, thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Tyler Higgins. I'm currently a fourth year college student. And when I was a bit younger, I participated in a partial Spanish immersion program in preschool and elementary school. And even while I'm a bit removed from those years now, I continue to reap the benefits of being an early language learner. And so I think that for me, these advantages have fallen into two main buckets. And I think the first would be linguistic confidence, I would say. So I have become very interested in foreign languages from a young age. I was always interested in foreign cultures. It has influenced my major in college. I'm studying international relations and affairs, and that was certainly influenced by the lessons and exposure that I received as a young child. And I've also had the fascination to learn other languages. And so even though I started with Spanish, I have now minored in Portuguese in college. And, you know, I'm hoping to always learn more and tack on some extra languages as well. But I think the second bucket would also be cultural curiosity. As I said, from a young age, I was always interested in learning new cultures and exploring. And so I've had the opportunity to study abroad in three different countries. And just all of those experiences have really just enriched my life and allowed me to see the world from different perspectives. So I think that all of that has really come from a great outset as an early language learner.
Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. I appreciate you taking the time. We had the brief intro video from me. That was, almost two years ago now, so a little bit outdated, but I just wanted to chat about the perspective that having an immersive life, a life impacted by languages, the impact that it has on someone, and how you can use your own personal experiences with language to advocate and spread the importance of languages to other people. So if we flip to the next slide, my first point is just, you can flip the narrative. I think a lot of times people push back against learning languages because it's new, it's something that's a bit scary, it's kind of outside of their comfort zone. And I think you can just help people flip the narrative and flip their manner of thinking about this towards a curiosity-focused perspective, one that looks at the positives and the benefits and the opportunities of language as opposed to the drawbacks. So I just listed some things that I've heard before. And then on the right-hand side, I listed some of the amazing counter arguments I've heard against it, or just some quotes specifically from Trevor Noah about how it doesn't matter if you have an accent or you can't speak everything perfectly, you don't know every vocabulary word. Like, there are so many benefits to language that are not about just the perfect mastery of the language. And I think that's something that is very helpful to share with people. If we go to the next slide, I also think that evidence is always very helpful. And this is just a few of the benefits that I've seen from an NPR article that I read about the benefits of language learning from a young age, whether it be attention in school, like reading comprehension in English, exposure to a variety of ideas and diversity of thought, empathy for other people and cultures, and an understanding that your culture and your way is not the correct or perfect way. There are so many other amazing ways to experience the world, as well as childhood school performance. And lastly, just long-term brain performance and acuity. And so those are all things that you can have in your back pocket. You can think of examples in your own life where you experience a benefit such as this from the languages that you know, and bring that to the forefront when you talk to people. And then finally, if we move on to the last slide, bring your own experiences, share photos, share the funny times you had with people, the times where you messed up a language and you got laughed at, but it was kind of silly. And like, you'll never forget that word again. And like, share all of the different places that languages have brought you. And so this is just a few photos of me experiencing a mix of different cultures and places around the world that I probably would not have ever had the chance to experience had I not had the language skills and language upbringing that I had. So thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Okay, I think we need to advance to the next slide. Our committee co-chairs have some questions for the panelists. And I'll remind everyone else to please put your questions in the chat. Any questions you have for either of the three panelists, and Pam and Brenda will field those questions for you as well. So Pam and Brenda, take it away.
So I think in order to make sure we get to the presenters' questions, we want to start with the ones that we've seen in the chat, and then we'll come back to these. So we do have two questions for Megan. Also, thank you to all three presenters. You guys are fantastic. The first question, Megan, was, will ESL be added to the app?
We don't have any funding for that right now, but we've talked about it. Certainly, we want to be as inclusive as possible. It depends upon funding. So we've assuredly thought about it. But again, it really depends upon the organization that we connect with and what their priorities are for us to build it.
Great, thank you. There was also another question for you. It says, it seems that you're trying to achieve multiple purposes and serve a broad population through the app, providing it's free with zero ads. Can you explain how this app is financially sustainable?
Well, again, we're a grant-funded organization. We go after, first of all, we've created this already from our own pocket funds, right? So it's established in and of itself right now. There's 40 lessons per language. And again, that's for the 12 more that we're also doing. So 40 lessons per, I think everybody should check it out and you'll see how very thorough it is with each lesson. But when we want to update the lessons, we'll need to seek funding for that. So we're really focused on that. And that really extends itself to the rest of the question is we go after funding. So let's say it's Mellon that we like, oh, great, they're looking for this. These are their priorities. So we try and do that. Unless a particular client comes to us and says, hey, we'd really like you to do this for this particular industry. Like, we've thought about Spanish for the medical community or for law enforcement, or, be it any other language where a particular population or a particular industry would be aided in that area. Like, we try and see where the needs are and then go after it, after funding to do that. And so that's the short answer. And then also, we're also open to philanthropy. So there are some groups out there, some individuals who are would love to stamp their name on something to say, hey, I did this for my you know, ethnic community or whatever they may be most passionate about. So we're looking at all angles to try and see how thorough we can get with this app.
Thank you. So okay, there's another question.
Sorry, I'll throw this out to all three presenters and you can decide who wants to tackle this one, but how do we compete with STEM industries that are putting millions of dollars into getting STEM courses at the expense of electives? Anyone want to tackle that one?
I'm happy to jump in with the university side of things. We've thought about some, like, you know, how are we competing, especially when we see grants that are that we, you know, want to go after. And it's, you know, again, another STEM grant, another this grant, you know. And I think really what needs to be addressed is the importance of language learning. So we do at the National Florida Language Center, we do a lot of research in different language areas, like the benefits of dual immersion programs and bilingual education within the workforce and you know, all this kind of stuff. We do lots of different things, but it's how is it important to other people and why is it important to, let's say, those with the money, the lawmakers and things. So we try and one, produce enough evidence that it's important, but also we're living in a new day and age, and video and short video and TikTok and those kinds of things are really, this is how we're disseminating information. And so in terms of what the NFLC does, we have a plan, at least. We're not on there just yet, but we've started doing little short videos here and there about why is language important? And some of the cool little knickknack things about being bilingual or trilingual or why, you know, anything in that realm. I think it's important that we get on a stage and a platform and constantly produce this kind of stuff and get in front of people. One of my strategies that I think everybody should use, really, I mean, I'm a huge extrovert, so I just want to be everybody's friend, but I go on LinkedIn often and I search for different people in different industries and with different positions, particularly the ones that I'm after. Like, let's say it's a district supervisors and language educators and wherever in different school districts or something like that, or if they're in the federal government agencies or wherever. And I just start making friends and then invite them to follow the NFLC's page. And quite often they do. And we are pushing out information about language and the benefits of knowing a language and doing polls and short little videos and this and that. And you'd be surprised with how much engagement is increased and how much more people kind of flock to this. And I think we're just living in a digital age now. We've got to keep up with the trends. And that, I believe, personally, as a social media expert background, I've been able to accrue huge amounts of followers just in these little bite-sized videos.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you. The next question we have is about pronoun guidance. And Victoria, I'll ask the question. And Victoria has kind of given an answer in the chat. But Victoria, I'll ask you to unmute and tell everybody the answer to this. So let me ask the question.
You've got to wait for the card.
Somebody's got their microphone unmuted. If you could mute your mic.
Yeah, this is a really contentious and difficult topic given our political climate and all the laws going on in different states. So the Professional Learning Committee is going to be addressing that on September 22nd. I believe, I'm not sure if it's 7 or 8, it was on this third slide. So maybe Sally, we could take a look at that if we want to just backtrack very quickly and double check the time. That is free registration on the ACFL website. So if you go to www.acfl.org and then you type in the search bar, critical conversations in world language education, you can register for that free webinar, and that's on September 22nd. And then sooner, prior to that, October 25th, our author, Chris Nisely, wrote an article on gender just language. That's going to be a feature article in Foreign Language Annals in the upcoming issue. And he is going to be speaking at our Actful, Not Your Typical Book Club. Our wonderful Dr. Meg Malone is helping organize that. She's here as well if she wants to jump in and add anything about that. And our editor of Foreign Language Annals, Dr. Julie Sykes. And those are really brief little 45-minute chunk of your time. You don't even have to have read the article. So you come, you're going to see about a 10-minute video of the author answering questions, really basically explaining the article. And so if you haven't had time to read it, you'll get a good synopsis of the article. Then you'll go into breakout rooms to work on reflection questions with others to discuss the article. And then coming back together for the final few minutes to ask questions to the author. So people have found that to be a very engaging way, and it doesn't take up too much time. It's just 45 minutes. So I encourage you to also sign up for the Actful, Not Your Typical Book Club. And again, that's free to everybody, and you can sign up for that on the Actful website. That's going to be on August 25th at 7:00 p.m. Thanks, Pam.
Thank you.
We have a couple more questions that I'll throw out there. There was one question that says, I'm wondering, how do we help our students in our ICT classes, specifically those who have IEPs and need another teacher in the room, but because world language isn't considered a priority, we don't receive that support to help those students. So I don't know if one of you wants to tackle that or if any of you have experience with that.
I don't know what ICT stands for.
Is it career and technical classes?
Integrated co-teaching. Okay.
Oh.
Integrated co-teaching. So I'm guessing that might mean there are a large number of exceptional education students in the class, possibly. I don't know.
Maybe we move to the question that was specifically for Elizabeth, since we are running out of time.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Elizabeth, it's the struggles of bilingual education in public schools is that many administrators don't see bilingual education as another entity for many teachers who choose to teach in these classrooms, therefore losing teachers and not being able to retain teachers. How do we convince them that bilingual education takes much more funding and support than a traditional classroom?
That's a great question to think about. One of the things that immediately comes to my mind is that we ask teachers in dual immersion programs to do a heck of a lot more work of planning and, you know, their time. So I think the first thing is they need to have a budget that they've laid out to look at. For example, in a dual program, I may have two textbooks for math. I may have, you know, two different textbooks, but I need that. I need teachers who are committed. And I know in two school districts that I worked with and consulted with, they had some of the few speakers of Mandarin. And in the other district, they had a few speakers of Vietnamese who were credentialed to teach in those programs. So one of the things that we did was work very closely with the teachers union to jointly put out a survey to teachers to find out who speaks these languages, who knows these languages, so that perhaps you already have speakers who could and who have teaching credentials, but who could get additional training at the cost of the district on them, you know, been on them, so that these teachers could also become credentialed to work in a dual program, that sort of thing. So thinking about losing teachers, we were able to talk with HR about making sure there are stipends available, but sometimes that becomes an issue with colleagues who are also teaching the same grade level. You know, why do they get more money? Why don't we get more money? So, you know, that's another issue that comes up. But if you lay out all the different expenses that are part of a dual program, I think you can see very easily or very quickly what is needed. Now, the question is, where do you get that money? In, for example, in California, we passed a bill a couple of years ago that provided several million dollars of extra resources in a pilot sort of situation, so that schools that wanted to expand or schools that wanted to try a dual program had some additional funds. When you go back to the beginning of this whole thing, though, if I'm a bilingual teacher, I can also just teach in English. And so I'm very valuable to the district. I can't, you know, I'm not put in the situation where I can only do one or the other. I can do both. And, you know, they need to think about that. I guess that's my thought.
Thanks, Elizabeth. That's fantastic. Everybody, thank you so much. Unfortunately, we're out of time for questions, so we'll have to address those in some of the other critical conversations or in some other way. We'll try and capture these and possibly be able to add some responses to the resources that are posted next week. Turn it over now to Celia.
Hi, everyone. First of all, thank you so much to our wonderful panelists, as well as to our committee chairs, Pam and Brenda, and for Victoria. It's really been truly a wonderful, wonderful session. We just wanted to say a few things before turning it over to Victoria to close out the webinar. So first of all, we'd like to definitely give a shout out to one of our partners, the Joint National Committee for Languages, JNCL. We really suggest and empower you to go to their website, languagepolicy.org, where there you will find out different ways how you can advocate for legislative change to support language teachers, language programs, funding. It's such a wonderful, wonderful resource. And of course, JNCL Nicholas Language Advocacy Days, we're preparing already for 2023. So we really suggest that you go and check that out. So let's continue the conversation. What happens after this? Well, you're encouraged to continue the conversation in our community. You'll find the recording of this webinar. I know somebody was asking in the chat, as well as guiding questions from our panelists and a closed discussion board where you can collaborate with other educators. If you have any questions as to how to access the community, please email membership@ACPL.org. And we will be more than happy to get you in there so that you can continue the conversation, as well as try to go in there to create a new program or a new project, really based on the guiding questions, as well as what you've learned today, to see how you yourself can advocate, how you can create resources for other teachers and educators to advocate. If you go to my.actful.org/criticalcombos, you will find the community page right there. So again, please note that the discussion board and subsequent projects will not be facilitated by ACTFL. ACTFL will not be involved in the logistics involving the conversations, follow-ups, or products. And whatever products that you and your colleagues come up with in the community would be great if it can be around 3 months. We'll go in there and check to see how it's going, if we can assist in any way, how we can facilitate the process. And once you have any projects done, please send them to plc@ACTFL.org, where ACTFL will publish your work on the website and disperse to the appropriate stakeholders. So what are some examples of these projects? Well, for our teacher and teacher recruitment and retention, we have some sample products here. For example, creating letter templates, outlining alternatives to certification, finding the most up-to-date certification requirements, identifying problematic or unnecessary barriers to certification, and brainstorming alternatives to these. Another project could be create recruitment materials for teachers of underrepresented communities to be used by stakeholders to bring more interested parties to the profession, or even creating a frequently asked questions pamphlet for potential teacher candidates whose L1 is not English in order to simplify the certification process for them. So all of these are different types of projects that you can do, but of course, having the advocacy lens. And with that, I turn it over to Victoria.
Great, we'll be closing just on time. I just wanted to remind everybody about our upcoming conference in November, November 18th through 20th in Boston. Now, this is our first ever hybrid conference. So you can come and attend in person, or you can also participate virtually. So you have several different options this year. Please go ahead and register for the conference. We have three amazing keynote speakers for our opening general session. We have Chef Jose Andres from World Central Kitchen. And then on Saturday, we have Dr. Keisha Blaine, who is a very famous historian, who is going to be speaking about the Black experience in the United States and around the world. And then finally, for on Sunday, our closing keynote speaker is Wajahat Ali, and he is a columnist, a political commentator. He's also a comedian, and he's an author, and he's going to be talking to us about his experience, his immigrant experience here in the United States. So please join us at the conference, whether in person or virtually. And thank you so much for attending the webinar this evening. And I hope everyone has a wonderful evening. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.